Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today we have with us Shalini Bhutani, legal expert, though she doesn't like the word expert, and a researcher, policy analyst. Shalini, good to have you with us. You've been following this issue about so-called intellectual property law as it applies to farmers for a number of years. We now have a number of cases, of course, the most important being the Pepsico case against Gujarat farmers on potatoes. Can you tell us what exactly is PepsiCo arguing against the farmers, demanding 1 crore rupees per farmer and then threatening with this threat, trying to get them to a sort of understanding by which they surrender to PepsiCo?
Right. Thank you, Prabir. Yes, this is clearly a case in which a U.S. multinational is asserting what it calls our legally granted plant breeder rights under a national legislation. And that's really the story where it's pegged, is that we have a domestic law, which is called the Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers' Rights Act, which a very clear chapter on farmers' rights, which was retrofitted into it at the time of drafting, to be able to balance intellectual property rights given to plant breeders, whether in the public sector or the corporate sector.
And this plant breeder's right really came from the TRIPS negotiations where
absolutely
it was either you give them patents or you have a sui generis protection, as it is called.
Absolutely.
Which you can give them other forms of protection.
Yeah.
And that's how this breeder's rights and farmers' rights got merged into this legislation.
Absolutely. That's important to trace that history because in 1995, when India became a founding member of the World Trade Organization, in the TRIPS agreement, there was a requirement that we bring our intellectual property laws in line with what the WTO was prescribing. And clearly at that point, because the farmers at that time were saying that we don't believe, we are not a society or a culture that believes in privatizing life forms, which means seeds and planting material, which farmers have shared over millennia, cannot be now privatized, commodified, and bought and sold. And therefore, there was a very strong movement against the TRIPS agreement, particularly when the Uruguay round was being negotiated. And India at that time had taken very strong positions saying no patents on life and in fact no IPR on life. And I would say that the Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers' Rights Act is a political masterstroke, because at one level you say that this is TRIPS compliant because we've opted not to provide for patents on plants. In fact, even in the Indian Patent Act, there's very clear
provision against life form patents.
Absolutely, and against patenting of traditional knowledge as well. And so since we opted for the sui generis route, we designed a plant variety protection law which is unique in the world. And it's unique because it has provisions to protect farmers. And this case now is an actual test
case
of how pro-farmer it really is.
Because this, what I think you've written about already, the Section 39,
yes,
says that the farmers can do anything with the seeds or the products as long as they do not claim the nomenclature of the plant breeder variety.
Right.
Otherwise, the same thing they're allowed to do. Right. And this is a farmer's right
Absolutely.
As opposed to a breeder's
Absolutely.
Right.
It's Section 39 and the freedoms that it gives to farmers and recognizes all the activities that they have been doing around seeds will continue as before.
And it has a starting point which is notwithstanding anything
very strong,
else in the
very
in
clear
act.
Legal language on that. And so there is no legal basis on which this case should be allowed for the
and
company.
PepsiCo's threat about for 1 crore damages and so on, which unfortunately the trial court has said prima facie there is a case. All of this is what would be in different language would be called using law as a war against farmers. Would you term it? I mean, I think this is fit case. But
there's
what
something
you
to be said about law. You know, law, they say, is like a spider web. It will catch the weak and the poor, but the rich and powerful can just shred it apart. You know, so it's really about who has the power to get what legal provisions enforced. And it's really now for the farming community to also show its strength that since we do not believe in this, and supposedly there is a national law that's protecting our freedoms around seeds, then all those who are responsible to have those implemented and enforced should do what they're meant to do.
Is it the first case of its kind trying to use the plant breeders' rights against the farmers?
In the India, it is a first.
It's a first.
But there have been similar cases in other jurisdictions, in other countries, Canada, USA. It's, Monsanto is notorious for suing
yes.
farmers to pursue.
Even if seeds are blown across the fences.
Accidentally.
Even yes. then, the farmers have been sued.
Right.
But they at least have a plan. They actually allow patenting, some of them. They have the UPOV, which
Correct.
Is the more sui generis protection, which gives a lot of rights to plant breeders, but very little to the farmers.
Right.
And as you said, the Indian Act is really unique. So
yes.
would you say now that this poses a new challenge for the farmers and the peasant organizations, farmer organization, and groups like yours, you know, other like-minded people who should
Absolutely.
Really get together on this?
Absolutely. I think we partly anticipated that this would happen. Because even at the time when the law was conceived, there were concerns that you have brought in the farmers themselves into the IPR system. Because a whole constituency, which was saying we are against intellectual property right, were now offered that we are going to give you similar breeders' rights. We are recognizing farmers as breeders as well. So you are also entitled to seek IPR. And in a sense, that also created a division amongst farmers groups of whom would like to get their varieties registered under a specific category called farmers varieties, which are not available in any other law in any other country. So we have registered a lot of farmers varieties, but no farmers potato varieties.
Okay.
Yeah.
But this would still be, shall we say, a debate which can continue. What the farmers should do, what are the kind of rights they should enforce or not enforce.
Right.
That's one way of looking at it.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no question
mm-hmm.
that enforcing plant breeders' rights on farmers
yes.
in this particular case
yes.
is a violation of the Indian law. And Indian law is crystal clear on that.
Absolutely. I don't think we should have
any doubt on that. So that's how we get together people to fight for the farmers, really the issue that the farmers as
right.
well as others, friends of theirs, have to work out.
Absolutely.
The other question, there is also a case which is even, shall we say, more onerous in intellectual property terms, our famous or infamous friends, Monsanto,
mm-hmm.
who have now argued that they have life form patent effectively,
mm-hmm.
the way they have argued for BT cotton seeds.
Right.
The seed is a patent, seeds can be patented, and they have
not
invention.
In India. Yes.
Invention, mm-hmm. same.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we thought that they knew that farmers could not be proceeded against
yes.
under the Plant Varieties Act in India.
Right.
So, similarly, here, that this is something which is should have been tested long back, but
right.
actually Monsanto never tried to enforce it.
Yes.
Now it's trying to enforce it. What makes this possible that they're trying to test what are the protection given under law? Do you think it's really the fact that the United States doesn't really bother about international law anymore? And it's wanting to use its economic, political, and even military power to enforce its laws on the whole world?
You've said it in so many words, and clearly there is a design there. We should be able to see through it by now. There's a long history of our relationship with the United States and how we've across the table have to deal with them at you know, the WTO multilateral fora, how they have brought in their standards in there on intellectual property rights, and now are in fact pulling out, you know, threatening to pull out of the WTO and make that system collapse, and suggesting that there be a higher WTO TRIPS. You know, a next generation trade and economic relation between
very simple
India.
One, not even
yes.
TRIPS plus, just
yes.
use US law. That's it.
Correct. And without any allegiance to any other multilateral environmental agreements like the Convention on Biological Diversity, because under that we have made a domestic law called the Biodiversity Act, which allows us local protection of local knowledge of seeds and farmers, and also access and benefit sharing arrangements with local communities. But now clearly their emphasis is how to enforce intellectual property rights. And look at the timing of this. Just a day after the case hearing, the United States Trade Representative announces its annual 301 special report, which puts India on a priority watch list for having an unfavorable intellectual property climate in the country. So clearly the fight is not over.
And it used to be earlier pharma. Now it appears that it's not only health,
it's or pharma ill health, plus pharma.
It's pharma plus pharma. Yes. That we are really talking about.
Now. Yes. And I think there have been a lot of cross learnings from that from other sectors as well, because there have been other non-IPR approaches that are being taken to fight this and as a pushback, as well as to also keep the sharing alive on what are otherwise, you know, material and knowledge which is being brought under exclusions and,
different forms of inclusions. Exclusions or what I would call enclosures.
Right.
This is really what the property laws do.
Yes.
They exclude some, include some.
Yes.
And of course, it's a propertied class that then benefit, and those who have more property benefits more.
True.
We will come back on this discussion, Shalini, again, and I think this is a much larger discussion which we can also look at other forms of enclosure.
Yes.
In the areas that I'm interested in, also intellectual property rights in digital fora,
right.
Data, software, all of these are today also issues. So it'd be interesting to have a larger discussion on that, but I think this is something that is burning at the moment, and thank you for being with us.
Thank you. Pleasure to be at NewsClick.
This is all the time we have in NewsClick today. Do keep watching NewsClick and also do visit our website.